Hello everybody, welcome to my presentation. My name is Markus Herbst and I want to present you some work I've done with my colleague A.Paraschoudis Parachutis, and we are both working for BETA CAE. What is the background of my presentation? Everybody knows that the NVH performance of a car is an important criteria for the car development process. Classical NVH analysis uses linear models and linear calculation algorithms. Is that a problem? It might be, because some parts of the car have clearly nonlinear properties. So what could be a way out? A way out could be to combine the nonlinear NVH analysis with multibody dynamics, which is a method to calculate the dynamics of a complex system like a car in driving conditions, including nonlinear effects. The purpose of the presentation is the following. First of all, I want to demonstrate you how to set up a process completely inside the BETA software suite in order to apply forces extracted from a multi-body simulation on a trim body to perform the NVH assessment. Secondly, I want to introduce a new reduced MNF representation of the flex body in the multi-body simulation. And last but not least, I want to investigate the difference between flex and rigid body in multi-body simulation on the acoustic responses in the trim body analysis. Here you can see our process. In step number one, we do the general model preparation, like collecting data, creating meshes when necessary, and things like that. And then we have two parallel work streams. One is we take care of the flexible components. In this case, this is just the trim body, and at the end, we calculate the trim body and cavity normal modes, which are used in the NVH analysis later on. And we also create the trim body MNF modes, which are used in the multi-body simulation. The multi-body simulation itself, it's the second parallel work stream, where we create all the bodies, the rigid bodies, out of the components like powertrain, chassis, etc. And we take the trim body MNF modes, put them together, run the multi-body simulation, and the outcome are the loads on the trim body. And in the final step, we put everything together, the trim body and cavity normal modes, and the loads from the multi-body simulation, and do the NVH analysis. Everything what's following now is just a detailed description of our process. Just a few words to step number one, the general model preparation. Most things are clear what to do. We have to create a mesh, we have to collect the data and so on. One important step is that we take care of the interface points where the forces are applied on the trim body. They have to be common in the multi-body simulation and also in the NVH analysis. What we are doing in the NVH model, we mark them with Nastron field 10 entries, we give them names. And then we divide the database into two different sections. Database number one is the flexible trim body and the acoustic cavity for the linear NVH calculation. Database two are the rigid bodies for the multi-body simulation. Coming to step number two, I would like to introduce an important concept to you, which is the display model. The display model is used in the complete process in the NVH calculations as well as in the MNF calculation of the trim body. What is a display model? On the left-hand side, you see the full FE. On the right-hand side, you see the display model. And the display model elements are much bigger. The mesh is much coarser, but important is that the grids of the display model are a subset of the full FE grids. That means we calculate everything with the full FE and output just on the grids of the display model. This makes every output much lighter. And the display model is the key enabler for a manageable file size of the NVH model base as well as the MNF modes. We can calculate or prepare the display model easily in NVH console. Now we have to calculate the modes of the trim body for the structure and the cavity. NVH console takes care that even though we are using a display model, we still have the correct fluid structure interaction. It outputs solution 103 decks, which we are then running with our solver Epilysis, which has an embedded AMLS. The display model together with the AMLS are here the key enablers for an efficient calculation of the NVH model base. Having calculated the trimmed body eigenmodes up to a certain frequency in the last step, we now want to identify the global modes. How can we do that? For example, the lateral modes can be identified by exciting the car at two stiff points at the front and two stiff points at the rear end of the car in Y direction over a certain frequency range. The torsional modes can be excited by applying forces in Z direction with an opposite sign. The vertical modes can be excited by forces in Z direction with the same sign. What is the outcome of the analysis? I show you this here in the bottom right for the torsional modes. We have 4 points, and if we collect for all three translational DOFs the results, we get 12 curves over frequency. I've taken an RSS value and the resulting curve is shown here. And then at the peaks of this RSS curve, there are the global eigenmodes. Now we know where the global modes are, but we don't know exactly the mode number, which will be important later on. That's why we figure out the mode number with the modal participation analysis. A typical result is shown here. On the top left, you see the responses of the modes and of the overall response. The overall response curve is the red one. I've set up the analysis that we want to figure out which are the top contributors for this peak, the top three. You see here percentage values, a bar chart, and the complex display of the results. And it's obvious that this peak is driven by this greenish curve, which is the peak number 19. So this way we can identify that the torsional mode at 22.6 Hz is actually driven by mode number 19. This slide gives you an overview of the global modes analysis. You see the response curves. Now I show you the numbers of the modes which have been identified by the modal participation analysis. In the table here, there is an overview given for these results. And there's another important information we can extract from this. We can say below 50 Hz are the global modes, and above 50 Hz there are no global modes anymore. This is just partly true for the vertical excitation, but more or less true. And this is the frequency limit that we actually choose for the MNF calculation in the next step. This slide shows you the last task of step number two, or phase number two. It's the calculation of the MNF modes. MNF modes are used in the multi-body simulation. They are actually mathematically different than the normal modes, which are used in the NVH analysis, but they turn up more or less at the same frequencies and have the same mode shapes. You can see here mode number 19, which is again the torsional mode. Important to mention at this point is that for calculating the MNF modes, we again use the display model. This is a feature that we have recently introduced in our solver Epilysis. The result is that we can drastically reduce the file size. You can see here for this model, the full MNF would be 7 GB, and if we use a display model, it's less than 10% of it. So this shows you that using a display model is a key enabler for manageable file size of MNF modes, which are used in the multi-body simulation. Now we are entering phase number three, the multi-body simulation and its preparation. What do we have to do? Roughly, we have the trimmed body, which is either a flex body or a rigid body. We have all the other parts, suspension, powertrains, radiator, and so on, where we have to define basically the kinetic bodies, which are determined by their mass properties. We have to define the kinetic joints, and we have to define the nonlinear bushings, which is a major feature of this investigation. And we also have to set up the tire road interaction. In this slide, you can see an example for a nonlinear stiffness curve. This is the force deflection curve for the front subframe front. Nonlinear stiffnesses can be introduced via tables, user expressions, or Python scripts. Of course, it's important to mention that also kinetic joints introduce a nonlinearity into the multibody simulation. The trimmed body that's in the multibody simulation is either a rigid body or a flex body, and then we use either full MNF or display MNF in order to compare the different ways of representing the trimmed body in the multibody simulation. This slide gives some information about the tire-road interaction. We have two tire formulations available, which is Pacheca's magic formula and F-tire, and we were playing around with the two of them. And then we had two different road surfaces. One road has the shape of a sine function, and the other road is a cobblestone road. We call it Belgium block road. The idea is the following. When we drive the car with a certain speed over the sine road, we can excite a certain frequency, and we set up everything so that it's 26 Hertz. This is very close to a global trimmed body mode, whereas the Belgian block road has no distinguished frequency content. Now we can actually run the multi-body simulation. Here I've listed you again the different variants. So we changed the body representation, we changed the tires, we changed the roads. We always used a simulation time of 1 second, and we always used the speed of 54 kilometers per hour. What you can see in the animation is actually the multi-body simulation result, inclusive flex body deflection, which we can show in our post-processor and which I think looks pretty cool. This slide is about the main output of the multi-body simulation, which is of course not the fancy animation of the last slide, but it's the forces that are acting on the trimmed body. I've given you here as an example the forces which are acting on the front top mount when the car is driving over the 26 Hertz sine road. These loads can be output from our solver in Nostron format. Of course, we are also interested in the forces in frequency domain. In order to transfer the forces from time to frequency domain, we use some scripting in our post-processor in order to do the Fourier transform. I have to mention here, this is the only time that we use scripting in the whole process. Everything else is standard functionality. You can see the curves here, and there is some interesting feature. The excitation is clearly a 26 Hertz excitation, and you see this in the 26 Hertz peak. But there are also peaks in the higher harmonics, which from my point of view is a clear indication of the nonlinearity of the system. We have now finished step number two, which was the calculation of the modes. We have finished step number three, which was the multi-body simulation, and we can enter step number four, calculating of NVH responses. At the beginning, however, I don't want to calculate the NVH response itself. I want to do some checks. And the first check is this one, where I compare the displacement at a seat attachment point in the trim body, calculated in three different ways. One way is the multi-body simulation directly. And the second way is the modal coordinates, which are coming out of the multi-body simulation times the MNF modes. If you really see into this result, you see that these two curves are lying line on line. That has to be the case, but anyway, we want to be sure that it's really like this. The third curve is the green one, which are the interface forces applied on the MNF modes, and they're also nearly identical to the two other lines. Why is this important? I wasn't sure at the beginning, when applying interface forces, that I really catch all the physical effects. Maybe I miss forces to inertia forces. And because I wasn't sure, I wanted to do this test. And as you can see, everything is line on line. That means the force approach is working. I think this is a good time to show you our process again. This is actually a copy of one of my first slides. What we want to do now is we want to take the modes of the trimmed body and the loads out of the multi-body simulation, and we want to combine them in order to create NVH results. The MNF modes were just passed from the linear calculation to the multi-body simulation in order to represent the trimmed body as a flex body in the multi-body simulation. And what I've shown you in the slide before was actually checking that the MNF modes and the loads create the same results as the multi-body simulation directly, meaning that everything what I'm doing here is kind of consistent. What I'm going to do now is I will just compare always the same or take the same trimmed body modes. I will take different load sets from the multi-body simulation and will combine them. I'm going to do that in Meta because it's extremely quick. Each curve and each animation that you're going to see can be produced within seconds. That means this process is very effective and efficient. Now we are coming to the first NVH results. What you can see here is the sound pressure level at driver's ear in transient and frequency regime for a certain road. What do I compare here? There are two curves which are line on line. Have in mind, the trimmed body is never changing, but I changed something in the multi-body simulation. And here I went from flex body using a display model to flex body using a full FE. Of course, that should be line on line, because when we just reduce the MNF file, we shouldn't change the multi-body simulation results at all. But because it was a new feature, we wanted to be sure that everything is working correctly, and this is shown here. Now we are coming to the main results of this investigation. What I'm showing you here are the responses to the sine road. On top, the transient results. On the bottom, the frequency results. On the left, the pressure results at driver's ear. On the right, the displacement at a seat attachment point. And what is interesting here is that the results which are created with the rigid body, which are the blue curves, the results are much higher than using a flex body in the multi-body simulation. This is true in transient regime everywhere, and also in frequency regime, the responses are much higher. This is the first major outcome. If you use a rigid body in the multi-body simulation, you get much higher responses than if you're using a flex body. In this slide, I'm just focusing on sound pressure level results at driver's ear. On the left-hand side are the results for the sine road again. On the right-hand side are the results for the Belgian block road now. On top, the transient results. On the bottom, the frequency results. As you can see, it's in all plots the same trend. If I'm using the rigid body in the multi-body simulation, responses in the NVH calculation are much higher than if I'm using the flex body in the multi-body simulation. I want you to focus now on three different peaks. First of all, there's this peak for the sine road when I'm using the rigid body. Secondly, there is this peak when I'm using the rigid body for the Belgian block road. And then I have two examples for peaks, one for the rigid body, one for the flex body at the same frequency. On the next pages, I will investigate the cause for these peaks. The way I'm going to analyze the four peaks that I've mentioned in the slide before is the modal participation analysis, which I have also used in order to analyze the global modes of the trim body. Here you can see the analysis for the sine road when I'm using the rigid body in the multi-body simulation, and I'm focusing on the peak at 25.5 Hz, and the results here show you the top three contributors of the modal participation analysis. And as you can see here, we are having mode number 26, mode number 28, and mode number 35, which are dominant. If I compare this result with the results from the global modes analysis, you can see that these three modes turn up in this table as well. Mode number 26 is the first vertical mode, mode number 35 is the second torsional mode, and mode number 28 is the third vertical mode. So here everything comes together. The analysis of the global modes and the participation analysis, which mode actually causes the global torsion response. And here we compare it with the response due to the multi-body loads. In this slide, I show you the analysis of the 22.5 Hertz peak, so the first peak for the Belgian block road when I'm using a rigid body in the multi-body simulation. Here, obviously, just one mode is responsible for the response, which is mode number 19. The next two of the top three, mode number 21 and mode number 35, are not really important. Again, if I compare that with the global mode analysis, you see all three modes are turning up in this table, and mode number 19, the top contributor, is the first torsional mode. So again, you can see that the peaks in the response due to the multi-body loads when I'm using a rigid body is driven by the global modes of the trim body. In this slide, I'm showing you the result for the Belgian block road when I'm using again the rigid body in the multi-body simulation, now at 31.2 Hertz. This is the second dominant peak in the response. And the modal participation analysis reveals that there is mainly one mode, mode number 35, which is responsible for the peak. And if you look now at the table with the global modes, you see again, it's the second torsional mode, which is the mode that drives the response here. So again, an example where the global modes determine the high peaks in the response due to the multi-body simulation loads when I'm using a rigid body. The last result that I want to show you is now again for the Belgian block road, now when I'm using a flex body, and it's the peak at 31.2 Hertz. And again, the mode which is responsible is mode number 35. And as you know from the slide before, this is the second torsional mode. So even for a flexible body in the multi-body simulation, the peaks which are turned up in the response of the NVH analysis are driven by the global modes of the trim body. Of course, if you compared flex body against rigid body, the result for the flex body is lower than the result for the rigid body. This slide summarizes the findings of the modal participation analysis. We have learned that the main peaks in the sound pressure level due to the loads from the multi-body simulation are driven by the torsional and vertical global modes. Due to symmetry reasons, the sine road can just excite vertical modes, whereas the Belgian block road excites torsional modes. You can see here animation of the torsional modes and of the vertical modes. Another important finding is that the global modes lead to much higher resonances for multi-body simulations with rigid bodies compared to multi-body simulation with flexible bodies. What is the reason for this? My explanation is when the car is driving over the road, the subframe bushes are acting on the body, and if the body is stiff, the forces in the bushes are much higher than if the body is flexible. So at the end, we have higher forces when we are using the rigid body. The tendency for what I've shown you and what I've explained to you is similar for structural responses as well. However, when you talk about structural responses, other local modes are also involved. For example, if you look at a seat attachment point, of course, you can also see the local modes of the seat. So that shows you that the sound pressure level is actually very receptive to the global modes because there is no local mode involved. I mean, there is a 50 Hz fluid mode, but you can show that this doesn't play a role at all. Now we are already coming to the conclusions and to the summary of my talk. And here are the key results of my presentation. First of all, I've shown to you an integrated process fully within the BETA CAE software suite, which facilitates using forces derived from a multi-body simulation in an NVH analysis of the trim body. Of course, it has to be mentioned here, you are not bound to use our solvers. You could easily replace, for example, our kinetic solvers with MSC Atoms, because input and output file formats are the same for both solvers. A further important point is that using a display model during the NVH analysis and for the MNF file calculation leads to a manageable file size for both results and enables the application of flex bodies in the multi-body simulation. This is actually one new key feature of our solver, that we can calculate an MNF file with a display model. Further on, I've shown to you that using forces calculated with a flex body instead of a rigid body in the multi-body simulation has a significant effect on the NVH results. A detailed modal participation analysis of the acoustic responses and of the global modes of the trim body revealed that the global trim body modes are the main drivers for the acoustic response of the system. And a very important point is that the differences between using flex bodies and rigid bodies in the multi-body simulation are especially pronounced at the global trim body resonances, which indicates that the rigid body in the multi-body simulation leads to higher interface forces at these global modes. This is one key result of our study. Now, coming to an outlook, what are we going to do next? We are still discussing if we should use modal displacements instead of forces when we calculate the response of the body. I mean, it's certainly an alternative, and the pro is that we would always have the exact same deformation in NVH as in the multi-body simulation. A negative point is that we just can use soft fluid structure interaction. And another negative point is that we have to use the same model base for MNF calculation as for the NVH analysis, which is technically not a problem, but the MNF file again becomes very big. Something what we definitely are going to do is we want to run an automated process. Every step within our process that I've shown to you can be controlled via scripting, and then we can put it in an optimization loop. Then an interesting question would be if we can optimize the nonlinear subframe bushes in the multi-body simulation in order to improve the NVH performance. This is certainly something we are going to do in the near future. Yeah, okay, this is eventually the end of my presentation. I would like to say thank you. First of all, thank you to the NAFEMS guys to make this event possible. This was really great. And secondly, I would like to say thank you to all the guys who were listening to my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. And I really would like to encourage you to get in contact with me. The best way would be via email in order to discuss ideas, or if you have requests what we could do better in our software, I would be really glad to get in contact with you. Yeah, thank you very much again. Have a nice day and enjoy the rest of the conference. Bye bye.